Because of the bread.
Yes, Lord. Yes, blood and bread.
Nothing.
Thank God for bread.
Take the place of the bread.
Yes, Lord.
The most precious commodity that Christ has or will ever own is the bride.
Amen.
Because she's part of him.
Amen.
And he's part of her.
Thank you.
Yes.
The bride. I got a bride. Nothing takes place.
Oh, thank you.
My mama, daddy, children, no one takes a place.
Amen.
I mean, that's the way it is. As far as I'm concerned. I mean, people put stuff in their own minds. It's not in my mind. It's my mind. Is that right?
That's right.
No one takes a place. My car. My going to the gym, I love it. Can never leave it.
Yeah.
49 years I've been with her. And she makes it known everywhere we go. Yes, dude. Ain't nothing wrong with it, but everywhere we go. I've been married there 49 years. Ain't nothing wrong. I thank God. And maybe it's going get on me one day where I said, well, I've been married there for 49 years. It has been a journey.
Well,
but can nothing take the place of the bride that I chose. Christ chose it for me. And I was lucky enough to get her. Fortunate enough to get her.
Well,
God has blessed us. I'm still here. And I have grown to be better and better. Thank God for the other day, Father. We don't want to go back to what we've been through. I don't even want to be young anymore. I really don't.
Amen.
Young and dumb.
Yeah,
I can say that. Can nothing replace youth but maturity.
Yeah.
That's all I know.
There's no choice.
So when you're young, you're just dumb. And that's not in a bad sense. You have no life experience. You just got here. How can you tell somebody what to do when you just got here? How can you tell somebody this or that and they got 15, 20, 30 years on you and you explain it? Be quiet. Just listen. Let Jay do that stuff. Tell me. Man, Daddy, you don't. I said, what? You just got here, boy. I'm 7 years old. Praise God. I can't even remember what I was saying. The day is a great day. And we thank God for this morning because a lot of things were said, but we stayed true to the scriptures.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yeah.
Sometimes you can't find the scriptures, you can't find everything you need to look for, but stay faithful to the teaching of the scriptures.
Yeah.
Enable us to come to good conclusions. And the bride is the paramount in God's relationship, Christ's relationship with it. With humanity.
Mm-hmm.
He became human.
Yes.
So he could get his bride.
That's right.
Thank God for Jesus.
Yes.
Cleared that up for me.
Mm-hmm.
It just wonderful.
Amen.
I'm still to rejoicing. Call him a bride from the Gentile. Old Gentile dogs. Call him a bride. It's all dogs. He's going to make you a bride.
Yes.
Yeah. Only he can do it.
Absolutely.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Great blessing.
Thank you, Lord.
We're just trying to maintain that thought. Stay faithful to the scriptures. There is a passage of scripture in the book of Matthew, along with that scripture in the book of John, is where Jesus was leaving in the 20th chapter, and he left, he gave the apostles some encouraging words and something to look forward to.
Thank you.
And placed the church in a unique situation. Everyone that believes in him actually is in a unique situation. Very unique. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you this morning, and we bind everything and loosen those, the Spirit of Christ, that it might minister to our hearts today for Jesus' sake. We bind the onslaughts of the wicked one that may not interfere with what the Spirit is sharing with us today through this teaching. We ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
In the 20th chapter, we're just going to stay faithful to the scripture. We're going to do a lot of reading. We're just going to, and if you'll read it at your own leisure. But this is something I think is so important. Verse 20 of the 28th chapter, not verse 20, but verse 18 of the 28th chapter of Matthew, it says, and Jesus came and spoke to them.
Thank you.
You see that? Do you see that? What did he say? All authority.
Oh, not some old.
Delegated, therefore, all.
He didn't come and say, I have all authority in my hands. No. I think Jesus was standing forthright.
Yes, sir.
Not shouting it, but making it very clear that all authority was given to him in his hand.
Thank you, Lord.
All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. All authority. And when you say all authority, that has to do with demons, evil spirits, Satan, all of his activities are under Christ's authority.
Yes, yes.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about what they're doing in Washington. If they're doing there's something there, it's because Christ has given the authority. Don't worry about Trump. Don't worry about Russia hacking, whatever they're doing over there. Christ has given them authority to do that.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
God is in complete control of every situation. I'm in one agreement with Jesus. And my topic is standing on a resurrected ground. Now let's go back to John's Gospel. Verse 13 and 14 of the 14th chapter. All authority is where? And read 13 and
14. You ask me anything in my name, and I will do it.
Now, all authority is in his hand.
Yeah.
And he just made a clear promise here. And whatever you ask, in my name, I will do it. That the Father may be glorified in my name, in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Now, we're talking about standing on resurrected ground.
Right.
Now, go to Romans chapter 1.
Well,
chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Paul, a slave of Jesus Christ, called to be called an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he promised before through the promises of the Holy Scriptures concerning his son, came out of the seed of David according to what? The flesh, who was designated to the Son of God in power,
yes,
according to the Spirit of wholeness, out of the resurrection of the dead, Jesus our Lord. Mm-hmm. There is a person, a human being, who sits at God's right hand now and has all authority in his hand.
Yes.
Let's wrap that around our head and receive by faith, because what we see nullifies that. What we see denies that.
Come on, Harvey.
Every day we see something deny that God has all authority, that Christ has all authority here. Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. Every day we see that.
Yeah.
That's why the believers are asked to walk by faith, yeah, and not by sight.
Yeah.
And it's also said that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So if you're hearing something that's not of God, your faith will never grow. It will never mature. And you can never have proper faith if you don't trust in him, if you don't hear the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and you're not hearing the news, not reading the paper, not reading some book, not reading some magazine, but hearing the word of God. It isn't saying reading, but hearing the word of God. Reading will never bring you to a faith in Christ. It's hearing and receiving into your system the word of God. Amen? If you're going to be saved by any other means, it has to be saved by the word of Almighty God. And Jesus is the word of God. Now, standing on resurrected ground, when Christ says that, if you ask anything in my name, well, you have to be standing on resurrected ground. What I mean is, you just can't say that and expect something.
Come on, Harvey. Mm-hmm.
You can't just say, geez, I want this, I want that, and it automatically happens, even though he said that.
Thank you.
But you have to be standing on standing with him in resurrection. You can't be standing, you can't be standing here and asking something and not in accordance with resurrected ground where he stands. You see what I'm saying? If you ask anything in his name, it has to be in that area where he has full authority.
Right.
And that is what? The church.
Yes.
I'm not talking about buildings. I'm not talking about denominations. I'm talking about people who are under the authority of Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Now, you can ask, but your mind may ask amiss.
Yes.
And it may not have anything to do with what Christ wants. And anything that will glorify God, it has something to do with glorifying you, or some particular thing you're involved with, or some person, or some magazine, or some music, or something of that nature. You know, God is not going to give glory to that. He only gives glory to that which belongs to Christ. You see what I'm saying? Now, let's be reasonable here. Let's be honest and close and stay with Scripture. If Christ rose from the dead, and we arose with him, then our mindset should be where? With him. To say that Christ is going to answer my prayer, we don't understand resurrected ground.
Amen.
I have a prayer But he has a prayer, he has a concern also for the church. If I'm asking something that's not of the church, don't expect him to answer that prayer.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes, Lord.
If we're asking God to do something for us that has nothing in the world to do with Christ, with his eternal purpose for the church, it doesn't mean anything.
Yes, sir.
Well, where did the car come from? You got a car, God bless you with a car. I'm not talking about that.
Nope. Come on,
Amen. I'm not talking about that. Because the devil can bless you with cars.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nice job.
Yeah. Sure.
Thank you.
Nice coach.
Yes, he can.
Nice people.
Yeah.
Nice buildings, chairs, robes. What he can bless you with all of that. But I'm talking about, we have been, the Bible said, we have been blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. So with those things that Christ did, and where Christ said, where God wants to bless us. Now, in that power, let's look at one thing that he says here in Mark. Go turn to Mark. You see, our intention here is to carry out God's eternal purpose, right, for the church. Chapter 16. For the church. So if Christ has petitioned me and called me into fellowship, and I'm working on his guidance and leading of the Holy Spirit, then whatever I ask in his name pertaining to the furtherance of the New Testament church, he's going to do it for me. Right? Now, if I need a car, he will provide me one of those. But that's not the main goal here. If I need a place to stay, if I need a new pair of shoes, he's going to make sure I get those in some kind of way. Doesn't have to be the best shoes. Doesn't have to be the best car. But he wants the best out of me responding to God, his eternal purpose for the church. And he can only get that done through Christ working in me or in resurrection.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
In resurrection. Look here. He said, verse 14 of the 16th chapter of Mark. And afterward he appeared to the 11 as they were reclining at a table.
Come on, Harvey.
And he reproached them and their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they did not believe those who had seen him after he was risen. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he said unto them, go where?
Into all
the world. Now, since authority, he's already said where authority lies. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. He said, now you go in authority. That's transferred that authority to them.
Yes.
Listen, church. You have authority from Christ to go and to preach the gospel. Mm-hmm. Settle in. I was talking to my wife yesterday. We was going out to Carolina, and we're talking about our check. If you write a check, I give that to the bank. But if the person who wrote it hasn't signed it, it doesn't do me very much good. It won't cash it.
Right.
You see? And you can sign it yourself. But eventually, if they find out that you signed it and that their right a signature is on, they'll come and get you.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
All right. Same thing about Jesus. Jesus gave these men here authority. He had authority. He was authority. He gave it to them. He gave authority to them. As they went out, that authority that he gave them manifests itself through them in their work.
Well,
can you see that? Mm-hmm. You have something to say?
No, sir.
Okay. It manifested through the work that they were doing for Christ and the church. He said, go ye into all the world and proclaim the gospel to all creation. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved. But he who does not believe shall be condemned. See, believe concerning is having to do with the new birth. saved has to do with baptism. Mm-hmm. New birth will not save you. Right. All it does is give you eternal life. Mm-hmm. Baptism saves you because it speaks of symbolic of saving you from the world. Mm-hmm. From your mental and physical state that you were in before, right after you got baptized. Mm-hmm. Because when you got baptized, when you were saved, you had that same baptism. And regeneration doesn't regenerate your mind. Mm-hmm. Only Christ can regenerate the spirit. And now, the signs will accompany those who believe. All right? This is what Christ is all, listen, church, what Christ is, you go into all the world. I'm giving you authority to go into all the world and to proclaim what? My gospel. Mm-hmm. To all creatures. And because I have given you the authority, I'm also in that authority, give you authority over certain things in the world. Mm-hmm. Now, what were those things? Signs will accompany those who believe. Mm-hmm. In my name, you will then cast out demons. That's just one of them. You don't cast out demons, but you have the authority assigned to you to cast out demons.
Right.
In Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Listen, the only way this can come a reality to us, we got to realize that we're standing where? In resurrection. Mm-hmm. Only the believer who is walking in the resurrection can these things occur. What I mean when you're walking in resurrection? You're walking in the spirit. Mm-hmm. You're not just being a believer and reading scripture and know scripture and know your books or your Bible and know verses every now and then you can quote two or three passages of scripture. No, I'm talking about a person who's actually walking in the resurrection. Mm-hmm. Every day of his life is a mature and walking in resurrection. He's not aligned with what the world says, not aligned with what anyone says, anyone does. He doesn't allow the political system, the musical system, the entertainment system, to actually control his thinking. To have anything to do with any decision that he makes. His decision is made based on those things that Christ has given him in the spirit. You see? I won't do this. This coming on tonight, I can't do it. I got to go see this.
Yeah.
And Christ may be asking you to do something else.
Right.
Entirely different. Because he said, I'll lead you and guide you into all truth. But if you're going somewhere on your own, so when you go to do something of your own, you actually abandon everything that Christ said, the authority he's given you.
Yes.
When a church is not doing what God wants to do, it has abandoned the authority that God gave it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's what happened with most of the universal church today, mm-hmm. is that they're working out of their own way of thinking, mm-hmm. their own maneuvering, their own ideology, their own stuff that they study and do for themselves. They're not walking after the Spirit.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. When you're walking after the Spirit, and these things will be manifested.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
What I'm saying here is this. It can't be hid when you are walking in the Spirit and you asking God to allow you to cast out demons. Well, what did it say?
Mm-hmm.
It said, it didn't say well for a particular time.
Nope.
It said, God said, you can cast out demons. Mm-hmm. Have you ever cast out a demon? Mm-hmm. I have. Mm-hmm. I don't know what you were there that morning in Gospel Baptist. With this big guy. You know, said, Clyde. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I was there.
Yeah. You remember that morning we cast the demons out?
Jesus.
Yes, sir. With that. Mm-hmm. Peter and I both cast that demon out.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
I don't know what Clyde is still living.
He is.
God bless his soul. But I tell you, he was a changed man after that.
Mm-hmm.
A changed man. So it can't, it can happen. Mm-hmm. But the Spirit has to be the one leading.
Yep.
You can't go around laying hands on everybody and say, I cast out demons on you. I cast out. No, no, you cast out demons according to the leading of the Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir.
Well, you got these these crazy folks that cast their hands on people and cast out demons, that's not where it works.
Amen.
Jesus didn't go around and cast out demons out of everybody. Oh, group, y'all have, come on over here. Mm. We will cast out demons today. Mm. No.
Come
he
on,
only
God.
Did, you set the scripture and you be faithful to the scripture. Jesus had incidents and situations where he did cast out demons, but never in a crowd, never in a place where he actually received a whole lot of recognition.
Right.
It was because of the demons present, that's when he cast it out.
Yes,
the man in the Garden of Gethsemane,
Gatherings.
And the little fellow that had these seven demons in him, and cast them out. Mary Magdalene, she had some demons in her. So you can't go around, because everybody doesn't have a demon in them. We know they don't have a demon. But you do know that some people actually have demons.
Right.
Yes, sir.
How do you know, Pastor Pastor? Because Jesus said so, right?
Yeah.
He said you can lay hands on and cast out demons. So he knows that there are demons in some people.
Yes, sir.
So let's get that straight in our head. There are demons who actually can possess people, human beings, who actually have demons living on the inside.
Amen.
And this is where you need the power of the resurrected Christ working in your life to cast out this demon or to whatever it is.
Right.
How many people do you know got demons? You don't even know nothing. Well, I don't know anything. All I know is when a demon appears, God leads you to cast out a demon, and you have to always be open for this. It doesn't mean that demons are just run every time you see a man act funny, a demon in him. Or they steal or rob you, you got a demon in him. Or they give you a finger, or that man got a demon in him. No, you can't do that. But in going out, he said, and proclaiming the gospel, if your heart is to proclaim the gospel, you will see those areas where need to be dealt with. Because the Spirit is going to lead you and help you see that particular thing. Mm-hmm. But see, if your heart isn't for Christ, then you will never see a demon.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Holy Spirit won't show up to you. You can't see him in a natural life. You can't see a demon working another person in your natural mind. Your natural mind is controlled by the system.
Yeah.
Your natural mind is controlled by your Adamic fallen nature. Your mind is controlled by your natural thinking. Only when the Spirit is in full authority in you working, he can show you where a demon is or where a demon was. Or the potential. Don't go sleep on it. Listen here. Either these signs will accompany those that believe. Let me make it personal. I had a demon in me. I think I shared it. But no one came and laid hands on me. I asked God to cast it out himself. And it did. It left that night.
Thank you, Lord.
Over on 19th 4th Pleasant Street. I landed my bed. You going to work. I landed in bed. And that demon kept wrestling with me. And I said, please, Lord, rid this of me. And when he did, he left. Just like that. And he said, while he was leaving, you know what he said? I don't want to leave. I had him for so long.
Mercy, Lord.
He won't leave.
I don't want to leave. I had him for so long. Just imagine a demon possessing somebody for years and having to do everything they wanted him to do. And then he got to go find some place. He plus he upset. It's my other place. Well, Christ, now you're going to be upset. If someone told me you get out your house, well, I've been there 30 some years, I'm going to be upset. I don't know why I got to leave. If a demon has housed itself in any person, and sometimes a demon can't house a believer, can't believe it, but it can influence them. He can be whispering to them with all this demonic stuff in their mind.
Yeah.
Remember, that demons are real, and they actually inhabit people. They actually live there. Mm-hmm. Wherever Christ is not, there's a possibility everything could be there. Mm-hmm. Wherever Christ is not.
Amen.
Then it says, you shall cast out a demon and you will speak with what?
New tongues.
Your language will change because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Amen? Mm-hmm. Now, he said, you will pick up what? Servants. That don't mean you go around you being a snake handler or going to these places where they do this snake thing, charming and stuff, and you set up in. That's crazy. Mm-hmm. But I'm saying you have to pray for these individuals.
Right.
But there are places where you may go and you may be ministering Christ.
Right.
See, in these snake charming places, they minister snakes. Mm. They minister charming snakes that God said you can put out, blah, 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 blah. And some get bitten down. But I'm saying here, Christ said, you're ministering Christ here.
Right.
You minister the gospel of Jesus Christ, preaching the gospel, and there may be something there to hurt you or harm you.
Yes.
It won't harm you because, well, you're under the power and authority of Christ.
Yes.
That's what I'm saying.
Yes.
The same thing happened with Paul. You remember the night he was in this shipwreck or something, and some people pulled him on an island, got him there, and he was putting a fire together, and a snake came out and grabbed his arm and bit him, and they clung to him, and Paul just shook it off, and the people watched him, thought he going to die, but he never died, and so they want to make him a god, but Paul said, no, I'm not, God looked out for me.
Yes, sir.
That's what I'm talking about. Sometimes, we don't even know how much stuff we got in us or we've been through that God actually looked out for us.
Right.
Anytime you're sharing the gospel, there may be dangers in invading the enemy's territory.
Right.
Anytime you come into the territory where the enemy has laid foundations, you know there's danger there.
Yeah.
But he said, I'll give you power. You don't go around drinking poisons. But in case you get bitten or get sick, he's going to take care of you. You don't go around testing God and trying God and making God do something. You don't do that. But you're out here preaching and teaching and sharing the gospel. God will take care of you. But you got to be where? In resurrection. Or resurrected ground. All right?
Thank you.
And so if you drink anything deadly, it shall do you no by means of harm them. And you lay hands where? On the sick. Well, you're going to cast out demons and he's looking out for you if you lay your hands on the sick. He said, that should be healed. Mm-hmm. Again, you got to come back here. You got to be on what? Resurrected ground. Mm-hmm. See, it's Christ in you that does the work. Mm-hmm. If you're not in resurrection, I don't care how many hands you lay on people, they're never going to get healed. Because it's you laying hands on, and Christ is not in that.
Yes.
When you're doing something for your own glorification, when you're doing something to make yourself look good, God is not in that. If you look good, then where's Jesus?
Amen.
If you sound good, then where's Jesus? If you're doing something and you're magnifying something, what are you magnifying? Are you magnifying self or are you magnifying Christ? That was a determined point right there.
Right.
It says, and then the Lord Jesus, after speaking to them and taking up in heaven and sit down at the right hand of God.
Thank you,
now, they had not received that power as of yet.
Yes, sir.
But look right in Luke. He's the one to give out powers. We don't give out nothing.
Right.
Give out a lot of junk, but he don't give out nothing. He said, you go and stay in Jerusalem until you be endued. Right where it says, then it said verse 4-5, I think it's close enough. Chapter 24. But all before this, he ate bread with them and all that after the resurrection. I don't think Jesus ate anything, but he did have some fish prepared for them. But let's get down here at verse 46. Let's go to 48, please. And you are witnesses of all of these things. One thing, the resurrection, the suffering, the resurrection from the dead. And that's what we proclaim. Right? Let's go back. I'm going to help all of us a little bit. I'll go back to 45. Then he opened his mouth, and they what? Understand the scriptures. And he said to them, thus is it written that Christ was shall suffer and raised from the dead on the what?
Third day.
That's the gospel. Mm-hmm. We should be preaching that. Not only should we be preaching it, we should be living it. That repentance and the church has the authority to preach repentance. Mm-hmm. Where do you get authority from? You got it from Christ. Right. And for what? Forgiveness of sin. We talked about that this morning. The church has authority to forgive sins. And would proclaim in his name in all the nations beginning from where? At Jerusalem. Then look what it said. And you are witnesses of these things. You were here. And behold, I send forth the promise of my Father. He said, I'm going to send the Father. You have another comforter. All that stuff. My Father upon you, but as for you, stay in the city until you be put on power from on high. Don't you go out there. Even though you believe in me, you've been resurrected, and you believe in me, don't you go out there. So you can believe in Jesus and not have resurrected power.
Amen.
True.
You see? Many of the believers, they regenerate, we have a knowledge of Christ, but actually the power is not it's not present.
Yes. Right.
Look what it says here. Mm-hmm. Acts chapter 1. Chapter 2. This is chapter 1. Because it talks about it again. And this is reassurance. Acts chapter 1, I think it is. And this is the verse 8. See, he also talked about in verse and with Luke, but also with Luke here again, or Luke wrote the book of Acts, but he mentioned again, but you shall receive what?
Power.
When the Holy Ghost what? Comes. Now, there's witness Lee Watchman, he said this. There is the essential or the dressing, not just, but the fact that Christ is in us, right? And then Christ comes and empowers us to live out whatever, the church. I hope you understand that. Now, it's just like a policeman. He got a uniform, but he doesn't know how to conduct himself because what? He didn't have training. The Spirit is here to help us, to empower us, to train, to develop us, to mature us, to open us up, to act and do the work that we've been assigned to do. That'll agree. Mm-hmm. But you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses. Both.
My witnesses.
What?
You shall be my witnesses.
Oh, yeah. Who's witnesses?
My.
Who is mine?
Jesus.
What are you going to witness about?
Him.
What about him? This is key. What about him? The death, the burial, and resurrection. And then you can be saved from your sins. This is the power that God has given the church. Now, if you don't believe that, you're not standing on resurrection ground, it's very seldom that you will even say that or teach that. Let me see. You could be born again and not really begin to teach that. Or that's all you teach. What I'm saying here is that death, burial, and resurrection. You believe in Jesus? Well, you need to be baptized. He saved you from your sins? Yeah. But there is no real life in that saying. You don't really experience anything. We've been through it for years over in our fellowship group with that, and we preached it and we taught it. Yeah, we saw Jesus, but that's about all we saw. But we went back out the door, but we never carried this message in a sense that he empowered us to carry this message, but we didn't carry that message. We carried criticism, we carried unbelief, we carried dejection, we gossiped, we lied, we did everything in the world. We were saved, but we carried everything but the message that he proclaimed that we were assigned to carry, and that was his death, his burial, and resurrection. That God will forgive you of all your sins if you trust him as your personal Savior.
Right.
That's what I mean. He said, you will be witness of me. What? His kindness.
Mm-hmm.
His love. Yeah. His mercy. His forgiveness.
Yeah.
His patience.
Long-suffering.
His self-control. Mm-hmm. His forbearance. His love. All that. But see, you can get saved and not give witness of that.
That's
the key.
Because you're still living in your old nature. You're still living underground.
Yeah.
As if you're still buried. But once you come out and begin to walk in resurrected, then these things will start to occur because you're walking in the spirit and not in your Adamic fallen nature.
Right?
Right? Mm-hmm. That makes sense?
Yeah.
No, he says, and you shall be witnesses of both in where? Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. See, that was a spreading of his disciples when they began to adhere at Jerusalem and spread out down the Ethiopian eunuch. Stephen witnessed to him. He carried it back to Africa. And Paul, Peter, carried it to Caesarea Philippi. He carried it up there. Mm-hmm. And so there was a spreading of the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
What? By those who had taking on this power.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
you know, you can't be standing somewhere and talk to a person. Slater, he's a member here at the gym, and he says it has to go in for a hip replacement. And so every time I think about hip, I think about replacement.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to have one, hopefully, the next 20 years, but I may have because I've been carrying on a load for a while. The thing here is that I said, well, can I pray with you? He said, what? I said, can I pray with you on the operation? Because he says he's a believer. So we stood right there. He's holding on to his weight. I held his hand and we prayed. Now I'm saying, how many believers, and I do it all the time, but how many believers have the nerve to stand in an open place and bow your heads and pray? This is what I'm talking about, power. That little bit there, that little gesture there had to take power. Because the flame was there, someone may see you. What you doing in here praying? Like, I want to stab them. What the business is going to say? What the boss is going to say you up here praying like this? This ain't no church. Oh, that crossed my mind. But the power that Christ had reserved for me for that moment, I took advantage of it and had prayer.
Amen.
In a service station, in a parking lot.
Amen.
Don't ever let the devil, because he can't, you got power over him.
Power?
Mm-hmm.
Sure, it's in you. He has already given you power.
Mm-hmm.
But the mind says, I don't think so.
Right.
Well,
the man said, well, maybe you can call him.
Maybe.
You know. He said, well, I'm going through something. Well, I'll be praying for you, boy. No, pray for that brother right there.
Well.
So by the time you get home, it's out of your mind anyway.
Well.
He said, God, I said I'm going to pray for that. A week later, don't. No, pray for that person or whoever it is right then. Don't. You got power? He's already given it to you.
Mm-hmm.
Demons are the one that's trying to stop you from praying.
Mm-hmm.
The spirit of a principality of power is the one that's trying to stop you from praying.
Mm-hmm.
He's just throwing into the fiery darts all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Stopping you from praying, stopping you from sharing about about Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
I'm glad you said that. My, about me. Not about Pastor Harvey, not about Henrico, Church of Henrico, not about any denomination, but about him. This building can't save us. Christ saves us. Denomination can't save us. Works can't save us. The only person that can save us is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, I'll give you power to overcome. If you're ever going to be, as Ella was speaking this morning, if you're ever going to be an overcomer, you have to have Christ in you to overcome. Mm-hmm. Christ is the overcomer. He just brings us along, but Christ is the overcomer. Mm-hmm. We can't overcome anything. Mm-hmm. Oh, we can't overcome anything. Because our flesh is so weak that once it comes to the flesh, you got it. I was listening to this book being read by Paul Michaels. Called prayer minister of the church. He said, when you walk into the spirit, man and woman, when I first we meet, here's a woman, here's a man. The thing is, I got to fight through all of this. The flesh. You wake up, church. The flesh. Mm-hmm. I got to deal with the flesh. Amen. That's what I see. Mm-hmm. That's what's reaching out to me. I don't know about how it works in anybody else, but I know the flesh is our enemy. The flesh is our devastator. The flesh is the one that brings us down. The flesh is terrible. If I'm going to witness to a sister, I can't have the flesh involved with this. If your sisters are going to witness to a young man or a man, you can't have the flesh involved in that. Because if not, the flesh will take completely control and you can't open your mouth about anything about Jesus. Amen. You're not going to say anything about Jesus because the flesh is totally in control. So if it can't work through the flesh, and if you can't work in the spirit, get away from the thing and go into your room or go home or go somewhere, but don't stand there because you're going to get yourself in trouble.
Amen. Amen.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir.
The flesh, flesh. First thing, she's a beautiful woman.
Yes, sir.
Good gracious, man. See, I'm trying to witness that. All this junk, all this filth is being bombarded to me from the flesh. You see what I'm saying? Unless those strongholds have been dealt with, unless those activities of the mind has come under the cross, you can't be very much witness to another female or a woman to a man or a man to a woman. It's not going to work.
Amen.
Because the flesh is there. And that's a natural thing. Mm-hmm. It's not unnatural.
It's natural.
And something else, you have to believe that it's natural. It's a natural thing. A natural. It's what's in us are natural. But you have to move to the what? The supernatural.
Yes,
allow the spirit to deal with all of this. That's why you can't walk in the flesh, you gotta walk in the spirit. You can't walk by the flesh, you gotta walk by the spirit. If you walk by the spirit, then that will be eliminated. Because the spirit is above you on resurrected ground. You're not in flesh, you're on resurrected ground. Don't ever let the flesh control your mind, your thinking. Because once you do, you've lost the power. You lost the initiative. You lost every little authority that God gave you, that Christ gave you, to minister Christ in a dying world. See the woman at the well? Jesus had no problem with her. Huh? You look at how he addressed her. He had flesh. He was attempting always that we are. We are what? Yet without sin. The woman taking adultery? All that. Mary and Magdalene, they were very good friends of him. He had no problem because what? He lived in the flesh.
In the spirit.
In the spirit. He lived in the flesh. He'd been a bit about bad as we are.
Yes.
He needed a Savior too. But he is our Savior. And he said, I have authority and I've given this authority to you. that you're going to live a life in the spirit and not in the flesh. This morning, thank God for you, Ahmad. We talked about the innocence, and then we're going to close here. The power that God gives us is the spirit. It no longer, it reveals to us that which is, should be seen. And the conscience don't leave my life. Every now and then it does, but it should be a process by which we're breaking away from the leading of the conscience. And the leading of the self-governing, I say, why do I take my own? I say, you're self-governing. You don't have any laws and rules, but you just do things the way it pleases you. That's self-governing. And then there's the law of the promise. Things going to get better. I hope they do. No, they're not going to get better. They're going to get worse. And also the thing of the law, where you place yourself under some law, some regulations, some religious activities, that kind of keeps you kind of straight. It does for straight for a while, but every now and then you find yourself wandering out here doing things you have no right to do. But under grace, under God's grace, God gives us life, and he empowered us that we don't have to answer any of those things, of any of those dispensations, under no disposition, because we walk in the spirit and not in the flesh. That makes good sense to me. So I praise God for that. The key here is that we have all this power. All this power. Authority was given to Christ. He gave that to us. Listen, church. We have a unique. Again, talks about the bride. How much he loves the bride. I want my love to have authority. I want her to have authority over everything that belongs to me, which is church. The key is us believing that and walking where? On resurrected ground. And resurrected ground is what? Walking in the spirit. And so the only way you can walk in resurrection, you have to walk in the spirit. And then God will lead you and guide you into all truth. Any questions, please? Any questions? Any closing remarks? That's fine too. What about authority? Do you have it? Are you practicing that authority or allowing that authority to work in your life? I'm not talking about you have you got eternal life and you don't smoke, you don't chew, you don't dip. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about have you actually put into practice that authority? Have actually taken hold of authority and put it into practice? Walk in the flesh, walk in the spirit, you shall not fulfill the things of the flesh. Know no man after the flesh. Now that's another authority that Christ has given us. To have power over distinguishing of the flesh. Where we let flesh dominate us and put us in pins. You got the blacks over here. You got the whites over here. You got the Jews over here. You got the Indians over here. You got this over here and that over here. And our mindset is that we see the flesh. We're not in the spirit, but Christ has given us power over the flesh. So that we know no man what? After the flesh. And there are many believers who are still hung up on this, these black and white issues. But if you're walking in the spirit, you shall graduate it. And God has empowered us to not to allow those things to hinder us from what? Carrying out his plans as far as the gospel. Now I need the witness of this white man. Yeah, I need to win. He's white. I can't witness to him. Why? So what?
Because he's white this way. You look at the flesh, so you're not going to witness.
No, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. And but he has given it to me. I haven't tapped into the power is there, but I'm not using it. Right? How much power is in us, but we don't use it? Well, I guess things are getting better. No, you have power in you And Christ wants you to use that power to continue to spread and share his eternal purpose concerning the church. Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you,
Lord. Any questions? This is First Sunday? What time is it?
Offering time.